we don't see well. And oftentimes, we're more open to this thought when life isn't working well. When everything that we've tried doesn't seem to work anymore. Oftentimes, that's when we're open to something new. But if we like our life, we probably don't want it to change, so we're not open to hearing new things. But as life continues, if we're going down a path, it even talks about in Scripture that the pleasures of sin only last for a season.
That's right.
It doesn't say that sin is not pleasureful. The Bible does not say that going the way of the world and embracing the world's values isn't fun. Because there's a lot of fun out there. But it says it only lasts for a season. There's a time frame. And then it says if we build our house on anything but Jesus Christ, when the winds come, because they will come. They'll come in everybody's life. They come in the Christian's life. Jesus in Matthew chapter 7, at the very end of Matthew chapter 7, he talks about how when the winds come and they blow and they beat against the house that's not built on the rock is going to stand. Because sometimes I think we as Christians think that somehow, since we know Jesus, winds aren't going to come, storms aren't going to come, things aren't going to blow against the house. Things will blow and shake us. But it says that the house that's built on the rock will not fall.
That's right.
Doesn't say there won't be tough times. But the house is built on the sand. It says that the crash was great. There's going to be a great crash. And sometimes when life comes crashing down is when we're more open to thinking that maybe I'm not seeing things quite square. And we've all been there. We all understand this. I do. You have any button pushers in your life?
Oh my goodness.
And you know what? Sometimes I used to think that the button pushers were my problem when I realized that there was something in me that was reacting.
Yeah.
And that's what I need to deal with. They're actually grace. When I was pastoring some years ago, most everybody in the, it was, I don't know how to quite say this, I think sometimes churches are like country clubs with crosses on top of them. What I mean by that is that Christians all gather together and they're kind of, they're not really into helping people or going out to bring the good news to others. You know, when you become a pastor, you don't get some manual. This is what you're supposed to do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I remember one particular day, it was early in the week, it was a Monday or Tuesday. I went to the altar in the church sanctuary, and I said, God, if there's somebody in this county that really needs you, would you lead them to me or would you lead me to them? 2 days later, I got a call. There was a couple in the congregation that had a house rental. And the man, he was so sick that he couldn't go to work because he has had liver disease because he drank too much. And he was a young man, late 20s. The doctors didn't know what to do. in. A church member who called me said, "They're open to talking to you, Pastor." I said, "Do they know anything about Jesus?" "I don't think so." So they began a walk with this particular man. You know, when I stand up in front of people like this, I mean, I didn't even think about this story until now. And I trust that God leads my words.
Yes.
And he had a problem. He had a problem with alcohol. There's not a question he had a problem with. He was in Worcester Hospital at one point and hallucinating. He had such problems. He was coming down the elevator. God spoke to me, "I'm going to heal him if he turns his life over to you. If he turns his life over to me," the Lord says, "I'm going to heal him." I was with his wife coming down the elevator. I said, "Yeah, God just spoke to me. God's going to heal your husband." And he was fighting. They finally sent him down to Columbus. And they didn't give him long to live. They didn't know what to do. And I told him, I said, "If you turn your life over, God told me you're going to get healed." You know, you might look at me and say, how can you say these things? How can I say... You know what? I didn't manufacture God speaking to me.
That's right.
When God speaks to you, it's different.
That's right.
You know in your knower.
That's right.
Everybody has a knower inside. You know that you know that you know.
That's right.
And that's where I was at. And I knew. I just knew. It didn't matter. You know, some people might think I'm crazy. But at that point, I just knew. It was one particular occasion. They sent him home. They didn't know what to do. Mike met with me at the office. By the time that we were done, it was maybe 8 or 9 o'clock at night. And I prayed over him. I don't know what the prayer was about. I prayed over him. He had opened his life up to God. But as I prayed over him, he was sitting on this bench, and he slumped over on the bench. And he told me later, he says, "As you prayed, you started to fade out." And he slumped over in the bench. He was there for maybe, I don't know, 5-10 minutes. And then he woke up. He says, "Wow." And he stood up and he was woozy. And he looked glassy-eyed. I said, "Can you make it home?" "Yeah, I think I can make it home." Here he is. He goes home. It's probably 3 miles down the road. He walks in. His wife looks in his eyes and say, "You've been drinking." Because it had that same glassy look.
That's right.
And she went out to his truck to find the beer cans that were underneath the seat, which she's done in the prior time. She's looking for these cans and looking for stuff and couldn't find it. And then she said, and as she was telling me this, it was a day later. She said, "What did you do to my husband?" I said, "What do you mean, what did I do to your husband?" "I didn't, what do you mean?" He said, he hasn't been doing anything and he didn't have energy, but the next day he got up. And he noticed that the lawn wasn't mowed, and he worked for 10 hours straight.
Wow.
And ever since then, and he started it again today, and I wanted to know, what did you do to him?
And when he went back to the doctor says that his liver is regenerating brand new cells, and he's being healed.
Praise God. Thank you, Lord.
But Mike still had a problem. Every time he went by the... Every time he went by where he
beer
would,
garden.
You know, the drive-through place where he would get the beer, he says it would pull on him. It would pull on him, and he didn't know what to do. I said, "Don't drive by there." I'm a simple guy. My name's Ron. Don't drive near, you know. But he got so upset. Cursed that thing, and then I knew he made a huge turn.
That's
when
right.
He finally told me this. He says, "I used to hate alcohol because of what it did for me, but you know what? God used that to bring me to Him. It was alcohol that brought me to Jesus."
Yeah.
And I knew he had a breakthrough. Because he's starting to praise God for the worst things that ever happened to him. And if you and I can start to praise God for the worst things that have ever happened to us, we've been released. That was huge. That was a blind spot for him. But he got healed. Praise God. We already know this. Sandy's doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. Some of us are afflicted with the same old disease. We just do the same old thing, expecting something to shift. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. We have to have new thinking.
That's right.
New ideas. We have to get outside of ourselves. We have to be willing to let go. To let go of what? Our stubborn resistance.
Right.
We need to let go of that. We've talked about this. This is the first blind spot. Ask yourself these kinds of questions. It's difficult for me to admit I'm wrong. How frequently do I ask for forgiveness? How frequently do I ask people for their opinions? Is it easy for me to admit that I've been approaching problems in unhealthy ways? Am I willing to admit that I might need help to move beyond the blind spots in my life? If this is difficult, then stubborn resistance is right in the middle of your life. It's very difficult for you to move beyond. There were some years ago, I still may preach a series on this, but I like the title of it. Moving beyond yourself. Moving beyond yourself. That's a huge deal. It was some years ago, because that became such a revelation to me. Pastor, some people would say, "Pastor, what did you do this week?" Well, one of the things that I really tried to do this week was get out of the way. Where you figured out the problem is that I get in the way. I have to get out of the way and let God have His way. I have to just get out of the way. If you're willing and obedient, we need to be open and willing to go a whole other path. Open. That's a huge deal. Some of us don't want to talk about certain things. We're just not open. Being open and willing. Next, we talked about this last week, arrogant entitlement. Remember the song, "You Did It My Way"? That's a huge deal for some people. It's all about their way. Someone said some years ago to me, it's not my way, it's your way, it's Yahweh. It's got to be Yahweh! Yeah, Yahweh's God. That's the name for God in the Old Testament. It's Yahweh. It's not my way, it's not your way, it's Yahweh.
We live in a world that encourages my way thinking. And what's the solution to that? Do nothing out of selfish ambition. Say nothing.
Nothing.
How do you do that? Man, you got to die. You got to die yourself. In humility, value others above yourselves. Boy, this goes against the American grain, doesn't it? We celebrate Independence Day. Everybody's for their rights. When we become a Christ follower, we lay our rights down. We don't have any rights anymore, do we? What rights do we have when we come, well, if Jesus is Lord? Blind spots. Number three, justifiable resentment. I'd say justifiable is in kind of quotes. Justifiable resentment. Do you hold on to your anger and resentments? Everybody has resentments. Everybody has anger. But how many of us know that if we have an angry and a bitter spirit, it's very difficult to hear certain people? We have blind spots. Someone that's gotten hurt because of a man or because of a woman, they have judgments towards men and women. And we have blind, and we can't even hear people anymore. We justify. It's justified. Has anyone hurt you, or do you feel that you have a right to remain angry and bitter towards that person? Have you done something so awful that you cannot forgive yourself? Is there something in your past, either that you did or was done to you, that has left you bitter, angry, or so resentful that you're convinced that it's perfectly justifiable to hold on to your hurts? Probably one of the times that I've gotten hurt most in my life is since I've been a pastor. You know it's a bad day when the pastor don't want to come to church. Elders going behind my back and lying to my face when I talk straight to them. I said, you know what? You know, what are you talking about? People accusing me of things that I've never done before. All right. And how do you think it is then to get up on a Sunday morning and preach? Who wants to hear anybody that has a spirit of anger? What child wants to hear an adult that has a spirit of anger that's in them? We carry, many times I believe, we carry bitterness. We carry resentments. And what it does is it blocks us. It blocks us from loving others is what it does. Because oftentimes we who are hurt put walls around. We don't want to get hurt again. And then what happens is we're blind and wonder why we don't have deep relationships. We're blind and we wonder why people never call me. People don't like me. Perhaps you bury your hurt. When you stop and consider your life, you realize you harbor this hard place in your heart. And you believe that people, and you believe that anyone who went through what you went through would feel like you feel. How do you know if you have anger? Remember, I went back to the, do you have anybody that ever pushes your buttons? If the anger's not in there, it won't come out.
That's right.
Actually, that person is doing you a favor.
letting you in on who you are and what's inside of you. Some years ago, and I've told this story before, I traveled. Well, last week I talked about how I was on a cruise ship, and I also traveled with this group throughout the United States. And we swore that the person who booked our shows took a map of the United States, they blindfolded him, they spun him around, gave him a bunch of darts, and said, Monday they'll be here, Tuesday they'll be here, Wednesday they'll be here, so on and so forth. Because we only saw a bit. This one particular stretch of 2 weeks, saw bed 7 nights out of 14 days. How do you do when you don't have much sleep?
Not good.
No. What comes to the surface? So we were there in Indiana. It was a good place. It was a nice place. We couldn't carry our equipment. I couldn't even carry my trumpet in there. Because they had some sort of union rules. We couldn't do anything. We just had to walk in. Everybody had to set it up. They did not set up our equipment. So we had to tell them how to set it up, so to speak.
Jeez.
That's just, anyway, that's America. It's a great place. Okay. And Tony Harrison, he's from Texas, he's probably about 6'3". Singer, nice guy, Christian young man. A little wiser than me on this moment. He says, Ron, what do you get when you squeeze a lemon? I said, I don't know. Lemon juice. I'm not in the mood, Tony. He says, no. You know what you get when you squeeze a lemon? Whatever's inside the lemon comes out. And if worms are in there, worms will come out. And then he just turned away and left. And it was like smack. Because I was getting squeezed in my life at that point. And what was coming out wasn't pleasant. Wasn't good. It was a revelation to me. It was a blind spot in my life. An extremely blind spot in my life. And I said, thank you, God, for the trials. You start praising God for the trial because I said, whatever you got to do in me to clean me out, God, please do. But God, would you do it quickly? I did say.
Amen.
And you know, the process goes a lot smoother if you cooperate.
That's exactly right.
Bitterness, harboring bitterness, is like carrying waste. It gets you hard. You lose that soul. Between you and others, and between you and God. It can destroy you. It can eat away at who you are at the deepest levels of your being. It can affect your relationships, your dreams, your hopes, and your decisions. If you have bitterness, if you have anger, if you have resentments, little chance that you have a lot of hopes and dreams. You've been disappointed and discouraged, and you have all sorts of turmoil inside. Resentment and bitterness can blind you and prevent you from ever becoming the person God destined you to become. I like the quote by Stewart here, bitterness and resentment only hurt one person, and it's not the person we're resenting, it's us. Because sometimes we think, We I'll show them, I'll be mad at them, and you know what? It doesn't do anything to them, but it does a lot to you. When I was starting the pastorate, I would have sometimes, every once in a while, you know, I had a kind of an open door policy. There's a young couple. They finally, you know, they're married and they finally have kids. And they, I don't know, everything seemed to be going well. But all of a sudden, the lady starts knocking on my door and she says, I have a problem. What do you mean you have a problem? I'm yelling at my kids. And it, I don't know, I mean, not that they're perfect kids, but I'm yelling at them. The anger that is coming out of me shouldn't be coming out of me on this little child. Oftentimes, we don't see our problems until we have kids or something. Because the way we've been parented, the way we've been treated, all the way down to that next level. These little, and she said, the anger that I'm feeling, they don't deserve that. That's called displaced anger. It's not the right source. And oftentimes what happened is that as we go back into their life, they buried some resentments and hurts that finally come up. And once they get healed from that, all of a sudden they can treat their children, they see their children, and they see other people so much differently. But they were blind to it. Oftentimes, we're blind until we have these other symptoms come out.
Right.
They surface these things. What are our choices? Our choices, what we can do, we can nurse our wounds. Some of us, that's what we do, we nurse our wounds. Well, I just won't be around certain people, I won't talk to certain people, I'll block certain people out. And sometimes, you know, we need to block certain people out. But you know what? The people don't cause the problems in here.
That's right.
What they do is they scratch the surface. Because someone said, they keep pushing my buttons. I say, well, disengage your buttons then. Why do you even have buttons?
We're buttons.
Get rid of those buttons then. Yeah. What? And I said, you know, it's not the buttons. It's what the buttons are connected to. They're connected to something deep in your heart. How about if we dig at that? Amen. But some of us nurse our wounds. Some of us rehearse the incidences. We just keep going over the same old stupid stories where we got hurt and mistreated and this and that. We nurse our wounds, we rehearse the incidents, or we curse our offenders. Yeah. We nurse, rehearse, or curse, or we can reverse the damage and disperse the pain through God's forgiveness. Well, they don't deserve to be forgiven. Pretend that you have a mirror in front of you. Look at yourself. Do you deserve forgiveness? Deserve and forgiveness are like oil and water. Nobody deserves it. Ephesians 4. It's interesting in the Phillips translation. If you are angry, be sure that it's not out of wounded pride or a bad temper. Or, as some translate, the King James says, be angry and sin not. Tell me how that's done, folks. How can you be angry and not sin? Most of all the anger I've ever experienced in my life is not pure, godly, righteous anger. wounded pride is in there. Oftentimes people come to me, I'm hurt by this. And I said, is your flesh hurt? Or is the Spirit of God in you hurting? You tell me what's hurting. Is the Spirit of God in you hurting? Chances are slim that the Spirit of God is in you hurting. Then you wouldn't be so messed up in anger. Because Jesus was described in Isaiah 53 as a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. I believe if we really consider the souls of others and how other people treat each other, we'll probably be acquainted with grief and have sorrow. But I'm not sure if we'll have anger. I don't know if I've ever had pure, godly anger. It may have passed through me once. I don't know. But never go to bed angry. Or as some King James says, don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. How often does the sun go down? Okay. How many of you guys eat chicken? Eat chicken?
Yeah.
What do you do with the fat? What do you do with the fat that and where do you put it?
Give it to the dog. The trash.
Yep.
Okay. You give it to the dog. Poor dog.
Back there.
Okay. I'll give it to the. Okay. Well. All right. Okay. Let's say there's no animals in the house like a dog or something. Where would you put it? You put it in the trash.
Yeah.
And if you leave it in the trash, and the trash is in your home, what happens?
It stinks.
It starts to smell. Anger left in a person's life and in a person's heart, it starts to smell. You need to take out the garbage. You need to, every day, take out the garbage, right? Don't let that.